Good morning. In spite of what the clock on the wall says, it is 8:30. We'll begin the meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance. The next item is invitation for a citizen to schedule time on the commission agenda for an item not listed. Yes, please, would you? State your name and what your business is going to be. And you might have to push the button. A green light needs to.
My name is Terry Knutson. I'm with Ag First Farmers Co-op. And there's a group of us here that are concerned about the inaction on Avenue 478, about a mile and an eighth south of Highway 30. That bridge has been at a restricted rate since last December, and it's really affecting all of us that are in business or that use that road to get our business. Okay. And we'd like to discuss that.
Okay, thank you, Terry. With the commission's permission, I'd like to make his presentation 4.5 right after approval of the agenda so that they can just stay right there. I think they're all nodding their heads. So we're just going to approve the agenda, and that way you guys can don't have to stay for the whole meeting. We'll get you in right away. Any other changes or adjustments to the agenda? Hearing none, without objection, I approve the as written and amended. Okay, Terry, we're going to give you about 5 minutes or so. There can be no action today, and we'll listen, and if we start eating into your time with questions, we'll keep, you know, that's commissioner's prerogative, and then we'll probably discuss another meeting. You know, we don't have our highway superintendent today. We're missing a commissioner, but generally speaking, we give people a chance to say what's up and then come up with a game plan from there. So go ahead, Terry.
Well, there's a couple others here that would like to speak too, but sure. I guess my main concern was is that that's a direct line for our business. We do about over 3,000 truckloads of grain for us just within our company come down that road, and right now we're having to put on an average of 9 miles extra. So since December, we've added 28,000 miles to our truck travel just to service our own customers. You know, it is a main farm-to-market road for most of the people north. There are other companies that use it. And I guess I don't know what's holding it up, but it would sure be nice if we could have a culvert or something put in just to get us by, because it is causing a lot of disruption in our business.
Okay, thank you, Terry. I suppose if the commissioner is asking a question right away, or do you want to wait to hear everybody and then, so we're not bringing it back and forth?
I'm going to be asking this question, so I just could give maybe Stacy a heads up since Dick's not here today. Are you able to look at that list on the bridge stuff that he has to tell us where this bridge is at and on the list?
It's next year.
Okay. Okay.
Well, that one's older, where it's at?
Oh, right.
I thought you meant where it's on
the schedule. No, not okay. Where it's yeah. Geographically mm-hmm. Located. Where do we have it scheduled for? And I just wanted to give you a chance in case you can dig and find that. Maybe you can't in here, but okay. Okay.
What did Larry say?
I'm Commissioner sorry. Jensen, you said what now? Okay. Okay. Thank you. I just wanted to know that as everybody was talking, where it's at on the list. So thank you.
Okay. My name is Dale Bown. I have a gravel pit there north of Bushnell. And I have two gentlemen with me, two different parties that haul out of my pit that just rode along with me today. But it really creates a hardship for those guys going north of the gravel. This one guy's, they're both from north of me. And so they have to reroute and go on gravel roads, which are dangerous and hard on the, you know, the township roads and the county roads that are gravel. So it's really been a burden for all these people. Now, I think there's a lot of milk trucks go by my place with these all the dairies in Brookings County. And it makes it very difficult for those people too. Canby grain hauls a tremendous amount of stuff by us. Hendricks hauls all that grain by us, and there's just, it's a kind of a ghost town in the morning because all the trucks go around the interstate to get there, but normally they'd be going by. And so I can see where it's really tough on these guys. But it'd be nice if some could be done temporary to get through this, you know. I think everybody would go along with it being laid up for a month or so in the daytime. It's got to be permanently fixed or something, but it's went on a long time. Thank you.
My name's Jack Nelson. I'm representing Valero Renewable, the ethanol plant out at Aurora. And some of this, I'm just reiterating what they've said there, but it does have a serious effect on us also this year through the road construction. It really gave us a good squeeze to what, or feel to what can happen there. But we pull grain out of the communities of Astoria, Canby, Hendricks, White, Toronto, up Clear Lake, that all that grain funnels down through there. And a lot of that, you know, that's like coming from the commercials direct there. But then we get producers also that are intermingled up in those trade areas that come down through there. And when I'm talking to people negotiating grain prices into the plant, it does have a serious effect on it. And, you know, I probably didn't really realize it so much as when we felt that when they were working on the bypass and that. But I was just kind of playing with some numbers, and it probably is about 3 to 4 cents a bushel when we route trucks around has that much effect on us. And just to give you an idea, we're probably pulling about 8-9 million bushels a year up out through that area. So the longer we wait on it, it does have a significant impact on us. So I'd like you to take a consideration if there's anything that can be done. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioners, comments? Questions?
I pretty much know the area. I mean, I live in that area, and I know the impact it's having. I mean, it's rerouting all the way around the interstate. It's quite a few miles added to your routes. And if they're using township roads or county gravels. I mean, it's hard on the gravel, hard on the trucks. I mean, I hear concerns.
Okay.
It's scheduled for replacement. Replacement bridge. Yep.
No, the STIP fund, which this bridge is not even in, we agreed to pay for this ourselves to get it done. Unfortunately, it takes engineering, environmental impact, and all that. So our intention was to have all this ready to go for next summer. That doesn't help you now, but that's the intent. And I wish Dick was here, but my memory is not the best. But here's Banner for 2013, and we have 220 bridges. I found this out because I have a friend that's a farmer up in Leola area, and I said, he's county commissioner. I says, what's it like? And I said, bridges are a real problem for us. He says, well, we got three in the whole county, and we have 160 that are under 20 or over 20, and another 60, 220 bridges that we're responsible for. And Banner goes out and inspects them. And we have an inspection. And my impression was that they didn't see the deterioration as fast. We weren't given a heads up as the deterioration as fast as it happened. And so that's the weight limit. And we've discussed it, the importance of it to that area, that we are willing to just take out of our money and just go ahead without waiting for state assistance or federal assistance or anything. That it's a crucial economic development part of our county. So that's my memory, is that it jumped, that we got blindsided on the engineering. A lot of times we get engineering that which the highway department looks at, is that sometimes we just repair them. But sometimes it's penny wise, pound foolish, you know. Pour in, and what was the budget that we put for this bridge next year? Does anybody remember the number?
Just close to five.
Five, yeah, half a million. So, and just to do culvert projects, I mean, I'm only 2.5 years into the county commission, I can't believe what a culvert costs. We've done a few of those projects, and they're in the 100-something. So just pointing out is, so that's where we're at. We certainly can discuss with the highway superintendent. I don't personally have an idea how to solve your problem now, but.
Well, I think that's what we can kind of discuss there too. And Tom's right. This one kind of snuck up on us there on how fast it deteriorated, because Banner puts a list together of where all these bridges are at, and we prioritize them. And this one was not on the list until how bad it got, and then we jumped it to the top because of what you're talking about. We know the traffic that goes through there. And then we also thought about the new, you know, state funds that are going to be out there, that this would qualify, a good qualification, because of the route and the stuff that would force the people using it. But we didn't want to wait for that either. We're going to move ahead and get going on it now. If it qualifies, great. If it doesn't, we're still going to do it, okay? Because that's kind of what we've decided. If it qualifies and the state will share in it, great. But if they don't, we know we need to get it done. The question is, what can we do for you right now? And as Tom said, I'm not exactly sure. I'd like to talk to Dick when he gets back here and say, is there anything we can do now to take that sign down that would allow that type of stuff to go on there, and see if we can do something? And if we can, we'll talk about it. But if we can't, we're just going to continue to move ahead as full replacement next year. And that's kind of where we're at. So, you know, and as far as I'm concerned, I want to get it done as fast as you do. And if there is a fix that we can do that's efficient, not $500,000 fix, and then fix it again next year. But we do have to go through a process, and it is a year-long process, unfortunately, especially for bridges. Roads are a different story. Bridges, environmental studies, engineering, it gets bogged down. So thank you for coming in and letting us know. I do appreciate that. And I know everybody here wants to get it going quickly.
But Terry, you did bring up a good point there. We'll check into it. Maybe possibility we could put some temporary culverts in there until the construction season next year. We'll have to explore that, check with the engineers and everything. And like Ryan said, the environmental, to tear that out and everything, we got to have permits and everything in hand before we tear that out even. But that was a good idea. It possibly might work. So.
Well, I think if you have we're going to visit more about this with our highway superintendent, but if you have an idea that's, like Ryan says, a reasonable cost. I mean, we're biting $500,000 bullet, and we did it basically as fast as we found out we could, but the procedures of engineering, environmental study, and having that all done to replace that bridge correctly, it takes time. We couldn't do it immediately, but we were advised that to my best recollection, because we asked about a quick fix, you know, just get us by for a few more years, and so we could put it on our schedule of, and it was a waste of money. And I realize it's costing you money, but we'll sure look into it the best we can. We are aware that, because that's why we're taking it straight out of 100% out of our budget. The state is going through a transition. There is these STIP funds and the way and it's out for 2 years, we're kind of finishing that and starting a new way of doing bridges. And we said, well, we're not going to wait for one. It's not on our first list. And we're not going to wait for the new program to begin. We're just going to go and do this. But that's the best we can do at this time. But I'm not.
Can you keep us informed for your
Absolutely. We'll stay in. Stacy is our administrator, and she will be attuned to all these conversations and pass it along. And appreciate you coming in, and appreciate what you do for economic development and Brookings County. That's good gravel up that way in Valero, and what they do for our community. I see them at a lot of community events, Terry, and my egg, with the egg producers. So appreciate you taking time out of your day to come, but we'll see what we can do to alleviate it. Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Question, because that all started before I came on the commission. Is Banner already working on the engineering for this bridge? Does anybody know the answer to that?
That's a Dick question.
Okay.
I believe that
my thought was that we were going to start that process even before we knew the rules of the new program.
Yeah.
My understanding was he was going to go ahead.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's my recollection, that we told him to go ahead. And so we get all that environmental thing out of the way, because it takes forever. And that was my memory. So
when will Dick be back?
I'm not sure. I think by Monday, next Monday for sure. But it might even be as soon as Thursday.
Is it appropriate for Stacy just to reach out to Banner and ask them if they're working on this project, just so we'd know where it was at?
Sure.
And then could you just let us know?
Because they're doing the other bridge. You know, they do bridges
exactly
all the time.
I'd like to know where they're at, and maybe then we're going to have that other conversation about, is there something that we can do to make it work for this season? But
yep. Okay,
thanks.
No, all the good points they had. Okay, consent agenda items. Anything there? The minutes, travel and education requests, personnel action notices, human services report. Anything? Any objections? Without objection, I find the consent agenda approved. Routine business, approval of claims. Motion to approve. Krogman?
Second.
Pierce, second. Any question or discussion concerning claims? Okay. Hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Department head reports. Highway department. We have a written report. County development department.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First thing up is I passed out my list to you, and we did have a little bit of heavy rain last week, and just some minor flooding issues on streets, and the culverts finally opened up. Once they open the culverts up in town, that usually alleviates the flooding in Brookings. July 28th, of course, they had a violent downburst for about a four-block area, and I went over to the incident, and then working with the Volga city manager, we requested two county highway dump trucks be brought over to help clean up all the trees that's down, and I contacted my liaison, and we sent two dump trucks over, and the city of Volga appreciates the county's support in that. We also had one farm up north on 197th Street. We don't know what kind of wind that was, but it took three empty grain bins, destroyed, heavily damaged the fourth one, and turned an irrigator completely over on its side and pulled the foundation out of the ground on the irrigator. So we don't know what kind of storm. That was a real short one, too. All these have been short. And if you think these are rare instances, they're not. If you've been keeping track of the news, Chicago had one, I want to say, day before yesterday, and then yesterday, New Hampshire just had one at a circus that killed a couple people because it took the circus tent straight up and brought it back down. Those are what we're referring to, just violent outbursts, straight-line winds. They're not tornadic. if there was tornadic, you wouldn't see any. Out in Volga, they had chopped up firewood for the winter season stacked along garages. Well, you go out there and you see all these trees knocked down, then you see all this firewood stacked up still. That means there's no rotation. The wind just came straight down on it and did its damage. And it's hitting the old growth trees. So if you live in the city of Brookings and you've got them old elm trees or ash trees, this is the kind of thing that's hitting it. Most of those trees, even the subdivision I live in, 40, 50 years old, you know, the trees are going to, as they grow old, if you don't keep them trimmed down, they tend to do this. We do have a zoning meeting tonight, and we've also got a second meeting scheduled for August on August the 19th. The August 19th one will be 8 a.m. meeting. The one tonight is still an 8 p.m. meeting. The Homeland Security grants should all be turned in. You have to start the process now of looking them up and see what they are. And we'll have a meeting later on in Mitchell on those, and then I'll give the board an update on what happened at those. The IPAWS contractor, they did contact our office. They sent out a new contract and we haven't done anything with this yet because we wanted to talk to the commission. You know, you gave us permission if we could get it to the end of the year. Well, what they do, they don't have like an 8-month contract or a 6-month contract. It goes, it's for 1 year, regardless of when you start it. If you start it in August, it's good until the following August. And I sent the contract to the deputy state's attorney for her review and Ms. Stephenson for her review to ensure that it met, that we had enough insurance that was quoted in the contract. So I guess did you want me to put it back on the agenda again for you to vote on the whole contract, or did you want us to?
What do you want to do there? Do you want to wait till January 1st, or at the next meeting, do you want to have an action item to have it begin September 1st, even though it follows the same anniversary date versus a calendar date? Commissioners, you want to have it on the agenda for next meeting?
I think it'd be good to discuss it. You know, we can decide then, but I think it's good to discuss it. We can decide then at that time if we want to.
Stacy put it on
because
the agenda.
It's not in our budget, but we'd have to obviously make an appropriation for it, or we can decide to add it to the budget, and I think that's something everybody we should have on for a whole discussion. So,
okay.
Very good. We'll add it to the agenda. Brookings Preparathon is scheduled for September 19th. We're going to try to have a county booth. I'm out that day in Minnesota, but I'll try to have one of my people there, and we're going to try to work with the law enforcement and see if we can get a retired RSVP person to attend. This is a free component. You see some advertising come out where it talks about where they want you to register for a walk, run, and pay money, but there's also a free component to it called a Preparathon, with an educational fair, and that's where people can go around and pick up items on how to prepare for a disaster. And then we're going to man that approximately 4 months, 4 hours. And then September 30th, we'll have our Brookings County Preparedness Day. The National Preparedness Day will be September 30th down on the main lobby of this building. We did attend a United Living Community tabletop exercise on July 22nd. We had Mike Holhauser from his office, Stacy Stephenson, and Richard from my office came over to it. We also had Beta attend. That was a good exercise, and it's getting some of the leg work together for further exercises. Next week, on August the 13th, we do have our full-scale exercise, and that's going to be an interesting day because we got two tabletops in conjunction with the full-scale. And we still got that meeting coming up September 3rd. If you want to sign up for it, it's online. And I think that is all that I have right now. We will have our state and local agreement coming up at a later time. Any questions?
The Brookings Preparathon, where's that going to be held at?
I believe it's over Larson's Park, ma'am.
Thank you.
You're welcome. We also attached a flyer, I believe, to your packet. At least I hope it's in there. Yep, Brookings flyer. So it should be in your online packet.
Okay. I think any other questions? Andrew Brimseth wrote me a letter, and you have a copy of that. I'm just going to paraphrase. He asked me to read the letter at the commission, and I mean, it's a little long, so I'm going to get going here. And I want to pass on a sincere thank you to the Brookings County for the response and assistance. Oh, he's a city administrator of Vulca. Week's unexpected windstorm that left about 4 blocks of our city in a mess. Upon my initial investigation of storm damage, I decided it was severe enough to make contact with Mr. Robert Hill, Emergency Management Director for the county. His almost immediate and professional response was impressive and extremely helpful in moving in the right direction with storm cleanup. Mr. Hill was able to make the appropriate contacts on our behalf to the state, National Weather Service, and local media. I had tried unsuccessfully to locate some of these contacts prior to Mr. Hill being on the scene. This is about 4:30 in the morning, I think, when he started that morning. Was able to secure resources for City of Vulga from Brookings County with one simple phone call, which came in the form of manpower and vehicles. We had 2 trucks over there from the highway department. These resources made a substantial difference in our cleanup efforts. It was a major relief that it didn't take long to get the approval and to have these resources in place. This is much appreciated. I think it was around 7 or so when we sent it. Several blocks were blocked, and so no fire trucks, ambulances, or anything could travel on those blocks. The 2 drivers, Alex Berkness and Nick Norgard, were extremely professional, hardworking, and very eager to lend a hand wherever they were asked. They were on the scene working with the city crew for the entirety of the day, cleaning up nearly the entire area affected by the storm. Before these 2 arrived, I anticipated that we would spend at least 2 full days cleaning up from the disaster. I can confidently say that the resources you guys provided sped this up and allowed us to accomplish this cleanup within about 12 hours. This assistance is so greatly appreciated. Finally, I have to thank Sheriff Stanwyck and his staff for eagerness to help and for their initial response. I want to personally thank Stacy Stephenson for coming over during the cleanup on more than one occasion to see if we needed additional assistance. And I would like, he'd like to be here, but he's gone right now. So that's from Andrew. So thank you. The county staff jumped right in and did a wonderful job.
Are we making sure that the 2 drivers each get a copy of that letter? That'd be great. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Continue with department heads. Vicki. Save Joyce for last this time. I think. See here. Yeah.
Good morning. I don't have much different, just business as usual in our office. And we do have our state auditors back. They came back on Monday. So we have Brenda and Josh both here. So they'll be in the conference room between us and equalization if anybody has any questions. And they'll be working here for, I'm sure, 6 weeks to 2 months. So if you have any questions, you can sure stop down and talk to them. And otherwise, any questions for me?
How often do they come?
I mean, every year.
Once a year, though?
Once a year, and they audit the prior year, so they're auditing 2014.
Because it seems like every time you say that, every other month, you're like, our auditors are here.
Well, yeah, they were here about 6 weeks ago or 2 months ago, and they were here for probably a week, but then they had to go to Lincoln County.
Okay.
So they left us and came back.
Right.
So, but yeah, it's once a year, and it is almost 2 months worth of work that they are here for. So,
thanks.
Thanks.
Marty, are you comfortable?
I'll pass to.
You'll pass. Okay, Mike.
Good morning. Well, things have been going pretty well at our office. It's kind of probably about normal with PAR. We've had about 120 calls coming in, made about 115 going out to different areas. The welfare side, we did have 34 people come in the last 2 weeks, and we had 46 veterans coming in asking a variety of questions. And I guess to talk a little more on the veteran side of it, one of the most common questions we get is, how do I get veteran on the bottom of my driver's license? And that was something that the NACO, National Association of County Commissioners, was one of the issues that they helped push through. And what it does is there's some different businesses that do allow certain, say, discounts for individuals that are veterans. And and then, of course, on the November 11th, I think every veteran finds their DD-214 and runs to Applebee's or any of the other sandwich places and gets their free 6-inch sub. But so anyway, it's a fairly easy process. They just have to provide a copy of their DD-214 when they get their driver's license renewed, along with that list of 37 other things you have. It's a little exaggeration, but two forms of ID and whatever else. But anyway, that's what quite a few of them have stopped in for, and I think that's a great thing that our veterans are entitled to and stuff. I also, as you can see in my travel request, I will be going down and we're going to talk a little more about the VA Research Council, which is what they're trying to do is get blood samples from a million veterans, and it's more or less part of it is to see how inoculations and different medications have effect upon individuals by studying the cell structure. And it's way over my head, but they offered me a trip, so I took it, I guess. Hopefully I'll know a little more about it when I get back and stuff. And I've been getting quite a few emails, but I think a lot of these people are doctors and scientists, and I am neither one, so it's interesting, though. The other thing I just got yesterday was a notice that the County Catastrophic Poor Relief Fund, which I've talked with Commissioner Jensen about before, they are finally going to have a meeting again. Part of it is to look up, you know, kind of look at how the that particular fund is being managed and how it is being used. For any of you that are not aware of it, the County Catastrophic Poor Relief Fund is if you are a county and you have a medical bill that's over $20,000, the first $20,000 the county is responsible for. If it's over that amount, then we can apply to the Catastrophic the Relief Fund. And I know it's got over $800,000 in it right now, but you basically apply into it. They have a board, which is a good idea. They now set up a board of individuals to review, to see if it meets most of or all of the requirements. I guess it's all the requirements, and then it's forwarded on to a group of five county commissioners, and then they say yay or nay to that fund being used. But there's been some confusion over the last 3 years on how it is being done. So we're going to have a meeting in Pierre on the 21st that'll hopefully clear up a lot of those questions. Any questions?
Any questions? Okay, that's it. Thanks. Joyce, you might as well come up and give your department head and then stay seated. You're a first action item, too. So.
Good morning. Very short and sweet this morning. To the commission, I would like to introduce our new employee in the Equalization Office, Melissa Walsh, and she goes by Melissa or Missy, and Commissioner Wyseth, Commissioner Krogman, Commissioner Jensen, and Commissioner Pierce, and Stephanie Miller is gone. And I have taken her around to the other offices and introduced her to everybody, so we welcome her to the world of county government. And in visiting with her this morning, she came back, and I think she's getting our process. So we just are excited to have her in our office and teach her the world of equalization. So any
great
questions?
Thanks for joining us and coming here today.
And in other business, starting on Friday, I'm going on vacation, and next week probably in and out of the office a couple times, but out most of the week.
Okay.
Any questions?
All right. Let's move to regular business. And that's item A.
Okay.
That's
what I want to just sit here. You're just
I'm not letting you leave yet. An action to approve abatement number 2015-009, abatement request made by Jared Foley in the amount of $811.26 for parcel number 40265-01000-035-05. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve for discussion.
Motion to approve for discussion. Is there a second? Moved and seconded. Okay. Questions and discussion. I don't know if Joyce wants to say something first or you guys want to just jump into questions. He sent a lot of material. Joyce, did you want to say something before we start?
I can just briefly explain the entire issue that's all contained within this paperwork. Probably 2 or 3 months ago, I received an email from Jared indicating that his property was owner-occupied, that he had signed the certificate of value at purchase time, and that was through the abstract office. And he felt he was owner-occupied at that time, and he wanted me to send him a refund check. And I then tried to explain to him in the email the entire process, and that's not quite the way government works. We just can't send a check. And I also explained to him the reason that we had not given him owner-occupied was because when you sign the COV at the time of closing, that is to continue the owner-occupied status of the property. This was a brand new property. It had never been owner-occupied before, and that we had sent him the official form. Our office sends that official form out to every new home buyer, purchaser. The certificates of value are not often distinguishable. Signatures, sometimes they're signed by the agents, sometimes they're signed by the closing agents. So we don't accept that in our office as the official form. The official form also has you sign and signature that you are the only this is the only property that you are applying for under a misdemeanor charge with their signature at the bottom. So we do require everyone to fill out the official owner-occupied application. Mr. Foley had not done that. This does only affect the school district numbers. The county has no bearing on the county's tax dollars, no bearing on the city's tax dollars. It is strictly school district, but the proper procedures and process was not followed, and so my recommendation on this abatement would be to deny it. It has gone in front of the city, and the city held up my recommendation to deny it.
Oh, the city denied it?
The city handled this in a little different way. They put it on their consent agenda, and so it just kind of flew through with my recommendation to deny it.
I just saw that one form with Tim Reed's signature in the packet.
And they recommended to deny it.
Okay.
So at this point, it's coming to the county commission on the second step. So.
And then the email this morning handed out.
Jared's mother is Deborah Foley, and she contacted me late yesterday about what time this would be heard, and then very late last night contacted me to say should she be here, and she wasn't able to be here. So this morning she sent me the email that was handed out to you earlier indicating that she has been in contact with the state, requesting them to review this form and maybe change that up a little bit, and just requesting that this be approved. Any questions from the board?
You said in Brookings County we do it this way. The way we do it, is it statewide?
Most of the counties require an official application form on file. We put these in the files. We know that this is their signature. They're signing it. We know who's doing it. All of the questions are properly answered, and the forms are sent out on every sale. If we don't receive them from the realtors, or, you know, a lot of realtors bring their clients right into the office with the forms. This just happened to be property that I believe was built by his parents. It's a twin home, and the parents sold him one half of the twin home, and I think there's even confusion in the addresses of he wants everything referred to his mother. He addresses send all my mail to my mother, and then I think there was confusion. And so.
That certificate of real estate value has been in place for a long time.
It has.
Have you had this happen before?
Not exactly in this manner. No.
Where somebody didn't fill out that second form?
Right, right. And I think I gave you a copy of the signed one, which you can't hardly read it. I gave you an empty one that says specifically, these items are important to complete for property to continue to be classified as owner-occupied for a lower property tax rate. This had never been owner-occupied. And then I believe I gave you the instruction sheet for the certificate of value, which again says that this is for continue, to maintain the classification of owner-occupied. So, and we hate to see things like this happen, but it's part of the process, procedures and processes.
Any other questions or thoughts? None? Okay, call the roll.
Krogman?
No.
Miller?
She's not.
Jensen?
No.
Pierce?
No.
Wyseth?
No.
Motion fails.
Item B, action to approve a 2015 Emergency Management State and Local Agreement Addendum. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Pierce, Krogman. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman and Board, this agreement states that they're pay up to the price, the limits on your thing, $42,000 plus. With the departure of my previous deputy, we will probably be close to getting $39,000 to $40,000 with my office activities. So the additional $2,800 or whatever it is would probably be for the siren from White. I'm going to put that application in once the siren's installed in White. I'm going to put that down, and that would be one of the projects we'd like to be reimbursed for, if possible.
Okay. Any questions for Bob? Any question or discussion on the item? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
C, action to approve agreement number 15-75, a lease renewal agreement between Brookings County and Denwell Investments Incorporated for the Community Health Services Office.
We'll move.
Jensen?
Second.
Pierce. Questions or discussions? Stacy, you had.
This is just renewing our rental contract with them. It's going up a little bit from $860 to $877 per month.
Okay.
How many years have we rented that space? Anybody know? And anybody know how much space it is? I was going to go out there yesterday, and I just did not get a chance to do it. I was just wondering how much room they take up. Thank you. Okay.
Any other questions or discussion concerning the item agreement? Hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries. D, action to approve appointment to the 4-H Promotion and Expansion Committee. That's in the packet. Joel Foster, let's have a motion.
So motion. Moved.
Second.
Pierce, Jensen. Okay, now question or discussion on. Okay. Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries. E, action to approve an increase in sheriff's mileage fees and traveling expense chargeable from 43 cents to 48 cents in accordance with South Dakota Codified Law 7-12-18. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Krogman?
Second.
Jensen? Questions or discussion?
This the state rates increased on July 1st. What that codified law allows the sheriff to do is to increase their mileage fee from either 3 to 6 cents above what the state rate is. The new state rate's now 42 cents. Marty asked that we do raise it the full 6 cents to 48 cents. And he can explain what this fee is for, I guess.
It's for mileage on servant civil papers. And just for to give you a little idea, last year in 2014, we served 4,619 civil papers. And we collected around $23,000 in mileage serving those papers. So this is usually goes out to attorneys and collection agencies. If somebody from the public is suing somebody and we have to serve papers, you know, we'll charge that person mileage also. But the majority of it comes from attorney offices and credit bureaus that are delinquent on payments and so. So we serve a lot of papers. And that's usually the trend around. It's usually over 4,000 sets of papers that we serve a year on the civil side, and that's not including the criminal warrants, but we don't charge mileage on criminal warrants.
Okay, any questions for the sheriff? Okay. Well, hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries. Okay, F, action to approve the appointment of Dr. Richard Heeb as Brookings County Coroner as per South Dakota Codified Law 3-4-3. Appointment will begin September 1st, 2015. And before you make a motion, do we need to, you kind of put in there about the ending date.
There was, in the consent agenda, there was a personnel action notice for Joni Holm resigning her, that position as coroner, effective the end of August, the end of this month. Dr. Heeb has agreed to be the coroner now for the county. This is an elected position. It's actually the four-year term is up at the end of, excuse me, at the end of 2016. So we'll go through that process of advertising that for petitions to be filed next year. We'll go through that process. But this is just basically an appointment. Each year you appoint the coroner position because nobody ever runs for that position. And you do that typically January 1st when you make your annual appointments. And you can continue to do that. You can have this run, you know, until the end of the year and reappoint in January. Or because this is, we're getting already close to the end, you know, halfway through 2015, you could make this appointment effective through the end of 2016, see what happens with the election, and then reappoint, if necessary, January of 2017. I guess those are your options.
I think we should do the latter of those two things.
The 2016? Okay, so
appoint through the end of 2016.
Yeah, so the motion would be as written there, and September 1st, 2015 through December 31st, 2016.
I would move approval of that motion.
Pierce and Jensen. Marty, I saw you standing there.
Just wanted, we're going to need to talk about wages, but I'm going to put something together for the next meeting and present to you that, you know, the statute doesn't indicate that the coroner's got the right to mileage and fees and things like this that in the performance of their job, but they really don't talk about salary. So that's set by the county commission, but it's been low. You know, Dr. Heeb said he wasn't in it for the money, but I think we have to. I think we're lucky that we got the medical profession to step forward and do this. So the coroners I've contacted were both funeral home directors that I talked about their wages and stuff, and it's all over the board. It's from $48 a call to $160 a call. The coroner in Brown County says that when he puts everything together, it's probably about $12,000. Because there's, as Joni talked about last time she was here, there's some things behind the scenes that I wasn't even aware of when it comes to coroner. It's not just signing off on law enforcement calls where someone calls up and says my loved one or someone passed away in the house and this type of stuff. They also have to sign certain deaths that happen in the hospital and nursing homes and things like that. So there's another, and they have to do the research for the death certificate and things like this to sign the appropriate death certificate. So I think it's appropriate that we probably try to raise that wage up a little bit. The other thing is that I'm going to have to get a supplement for the present coroner. I think there's around $6,000 left. I budgeted $20,000 for autopsies, and I just paid off. Paid for one not too long ago, and that pretty much depletes that $20,000. Part of the problem is I had to pay $7,000 up front because of last year's autopsy, just because of billing. But I think we can save some money in some areas too, so that it'll kind of make up for the wage increase. But I think we need to look at raising that wage up a little bit so that, again, I think we're lucky that we have someone from the medical wanting to step up to the plate on that.
Comments, sir? Well, I want to thank Joni Holm for
of course.
It's great. She was a medical professional that all the years of service, and I heard Dr. Heeb was interested. I don't know him as a professional, but just as a person involved in the community. And I do look that it's almost charity work on his part, and we need to be fair about it, but it's great to have a medical professional such as Dr. Heeb step forward. I don't know if Joni bribed him or you did or just it's great that.
Well, he's working on a red light, but I haven't promised him a red light. He wants a red light, but I said I'd get him a badge, but not a red light yet. So, but and I want to thank Joni Holm too. She's been coroner about as long as I've been sheriff, and I think she started right after I. You know, it used to be a rotation for the medical doctors. Is every 2 years one of them stepped forward and did it, and then that kind of went away just before I got elected and stuff. And then Joni stepped up to the plate, and so she, you know, I would like to thank Joni Holm too publicly that for her years of service and it wasn't a moneymaker for her either, but she did it because she kind of enjoyed doing that. And after a while, it doesn't become fun anymore. You know, other than that, wasn't a fun job, but it was interesting and so forth. But there's more demands on this. That Brookings County's getting bigger. We're having more things going on. So it's the demand on it is a little more there too. So,
well, their free time. I've been with Joni at the lake or whatever and have her pick up a phone and said, catch you later. And have to leave the gathering. So it's, quite a commitment to their free time, personal
Absolutely.
Time. So, okay, well, thank you. Any other questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Okay, Commission Department Director report.
I submitted my report with the packet, of course, and so just some of these are just going through that. But Achievement Days is going on now as we speak. Started yesterday. Just a reminder, this Thursday is the barbecue, and I believe that you've been all asked to serve at that. It's from 5 to 7, of course, out at the Swift Health Center. The board received an email from Brookings County resident Bob Burnt regarding the bridge that we actually discussed this morning. He lives on 477th near that bridge, and due to the extra traffic, he's receiving a lot of dust on his property now because the big trucks are using his township road now to get around that bridge. The email was a part of my report. I think he's asking if there's anything that we can do to help.
Well, since you took a pause, did you guys want to discuss that at all? Or is that a...
It's up to you.
Okay. Did you want to discuss... Because I think most of you got a phone call from him. Did you want to discuss it at all as a board? I guess the only idea... I had a couple ideas, and I found out I was wrong with all of them. One was anytime there is a detour, and this is a semi-detour, highway department, state or whatever, provide an alternate route. We do have weight restrictions all over the place, but I guess if Dick was here, I'd ask how many weight restrictions we have on county roads that cause a detour.
We currently have 46 bridges that have weight limitations throughout the county.
Throughout the county, but county maintained, not the township. I look at the township, they may be detouring for the last 5 years, and people are used to what it is, but this is a county road that gets a ton of traffic, and they're detouring from a county road, which you would assume would be a higher level. I wonder how many county roads we have that are causing traffic to be rerouted. And that would be my angle a little bit, that maybe we could look at from that respect. Because otherwise, like Commissioner Jensen and I visited, that if we started doing for every weight restriction, we'd be putting that product down everywhere. But just that'd be my, I'm somewhat sympathetic because we are on a county road creating a rerouting of trucks. It's not an official detour either, but.
But we can't do that on every road. I mean, even the next correspondence is another somebody else causing dust traffic on there, and it's not even a detour situation. It's normal usage, and the usage has changed a lot of times. I mean, these trucks that are going down are a lot bigger. The farmers are using, you know, large tractor trucks, you know, semis, rather than what they were using before, and it's causing more. And we can't, because of that situation, we can't just turn around and put the stuff on all of them. It just would get too big, and it's too cumbersome to be able to handle that. It's just not gonna work. And so I know it's causing undue, you know, stress on a lot of people. We had gentlemen in here talking about it before, the cost they're doing, and then the people living there. And so I think our job is to get that bridge fixed and get that going so they can use it. But to mitigate all the problems, I think would be I don't think we can do it. There's just no way. I don't think we have the funds to do it and the ability to do it. So,
okay. Any other thoughts?
I didn't realize until Commissioner Jensen told me that county doesn't do anything with any dust control. And I note on the form that Stacy included in the packet, it specifically says that. And I have some concerns about that policy, and I understand it's an economic issue when it is our action that's causing the dust, okay, which is the weight limit on this bridge. And I wonder if we couldn't look at some type of matching grant fund where we set aside some money, maybe not a fortune, but some money. And I understand that it costs about $1 a foot to put the calcium chloride out, where maybe the county would pay part and the landowner would pay part, and it wouldn't be just for this area. But maybe we need to look at when it's something that's not the normal situation for that road, but it's being caused because of some type of road work, bridge work, economic development. It can be a lot of different things where people could apply for some help with taking care of that problem. I think we ought to maybe consider giving people an opportunity to get some assistance with that.
Mr. Jensen, do you have a thought at this moment? I'm just going to say that we put up the weight limit signs on every bridge. So we cause it everywhere. And we start, like Commissioner Krogman says, we'd have this all over. But I'm just wondering how many county roads, the ones that we count on to carry the heavy traffic, because that's, you know, just like the CAFOs, you know, are good, better, best. They got to be on that county road for a reason, because we're going to have a better road than the township. And I lean your way, but it'd only be for county roads. And right. I don't want to open a can of worms. I have no idea how many we have with weight limits.
Well, that's my opinion on this too. You might have the bridge. It's up by White, but the trucks are going around 3-4 miles away on different roads, not just past Mr. Burns' house. They're going to the east. They're going every direction from there. You'd have applications from every landowner within a 4-mile area of that bridge saying, well, these trucks are coming by my house because of that bridge. It's different if the county's doing work on a bridge, has the road closed, and there's a detour route established. Then I feel, yes, we probably should do some dust control there. We always did do, if we were hauling gravel and we had to use a township road, we maintained that road. We took care of the road, and to the best of our ability, just to be neighborly. There's large dairies in the county that provide dust control to all their neighbors just to be neighborly during hauling of manure, chopping of silage, what have you. You can go 7-8 miles from any dairy, you know, they're making dust, but they help out. I don't feel that the county, I mean, on every bridge in the county that we have posted, somebody's gonna have somebody going around a different route just to avoid that bridge, and I can't see how we can afford to put dust control at all these.
I've seen a couple things, and one of the ideas that got shot down is that I've seen places where they have the stop and go light in the middle of nowhere, so one car goes over the bridge, but that weight limit is for that one vehicle, I believe. So that wouldn't solve that problem with those trucks. But around the country, is there detours for certain types of vehicles, heavy vehicles, and the detour is only for them. It's not for passenger. The detour would be for gross weight or whatever of X. And but I guess these are just ideas. The question is whether you guys want to put it on the agenda for the next meeting for further discussion. Think about it, have Dick here, etc. Yes. Okay. Or
I believe we should.
Okay.
If Stacy, if Dick can bring some ideas to the board, there's an option.
Okay. We'll put it on the agenda to discuss at the next meeting.
Well, you know, and the thing about it is we're not putting these weight limits on just for fun, that this is, we want to put it on here and that kind of stuff. There's a reason for it. And the reason is the bridge cannot handle that. Okay. And it's not like we enjoy that or want to do that, but it's deteriorating. And we found that out. And we're doing the best we can as a government entity to get that replaced. It's going to cause hardship. It's causing hardship on everybody, but we can't relieve all that hardship. When economic development impact is coming, we know they're going to cause their long-term problems, you know, on county roads or township roads. We can put a road maintenance agreement involved and try to make sure we mitigate that and take care of that. But, you know, this was not a long-term thing. This is something and these are short periods of time. I understand the hardship and the costs, but, you know, this could go on in every area. I mean, every person that does farming now and anybody that has wind farms, anybody that has dairy in the area could come and ask for us if we open this up. And I want to get that bridge fixed, and I want to minimize as much as possible, and I think we're doing as much as we can in the speed of government, but you know, every email or call we get for dust, we can't jump up and just take care of it. It's just not it's not feasible.
Okay, thank you. I think we got a consensus to put it on the agenda, so we'll discuss it at the next meeting. Okay, I interrupt you. Got another dust call.
Yep. From Brookings County resident Steve Cashins, who lives on 197th Street, County Road 40. That's up the very north. I think it's just 1 mile south off the county line. Cutting silage in his area, causing dust on his place as well. Said that the county line road, it sounded like they had used that a couple of weeks ago and tore that road up, you know, according to him, tore that road up pretty good with the added traffic. I think he's looking for a responsible party to pay for some dust control there. So I've included a letter that was sent to the state's attorneys and the commission chairs throughout the state regarding the Juvenile Justice Reinvestment Initiative Fiscal Incentive Diversion Program. That letter was included in my packet.
I guess there's a little follow-up that Commissioner Pierce and Abby, Ms. Howard, and Stacy, we communicated. I didn't know the state's attorney's got the letter. I got the letter. And this was something we discussed earlier, reimbursement. And so we're working. Where did we leave it? Abby's? Yeah, go ahead.
My office will maintain all the statistics that are needed, which is what we do anyway. And I'm not comfortable releasing that information outside of my office to someone else anyway. But so we will compile that. We've already started doing so. And then when the time comes for the application to be completed, we'll work with Stacy and make sure that gets sent in timely.
And yeah, so Stacy agreed. So it looks like we have an opportunity to reimburse some of our costs on the juvenile program. Okay.
And then Chairman Wyseth asked that I pass along the announcement from USDA regarding the first private sector investments, the U.S. Rural Infrastructure Opportunity Fund. That was included in my packet of information.
I did catch the hospital was meant, hospitals were there, but Madison qualified. Brookings doesn't because it's special, a niche. But I did pass on, and I, with the white assisted living closing, I noticed they were in there too. So I didn't know if any industrious people out there that want to get in the business, there's an opportunity for some financial support. Okay, sorry.
I included in your in the packet the profiles of service. This was in the NACO, the National NACO newspaper that goes out. For those of you that know him, Commissioner Jim Schmidt from Lincoln County was featured in one of the articles there. So I thought it was kind of interesting that somebody from in one of the national newspapers was recognized. Also, Mr. Hillett asked that I include some information on the Western Interstate region, that he some information that he got when he was at the NACO National Convention. So that is in the packet as well. A few other things that came out, some things I've handed out today. We received our fully signed copy of the JDC addendum that we approved a month and a half or so ago. I included that cover letter this morning on your desks with that. I also included some information on some census training that is coming up. That was on your desks this morning. The 8-county meeting is they've changed. I know that was kind of the discussion to change if they needed to hold those on Mondays. They've moved it to next Wednesday, August 12th already. So I just received this information. Vicki sent me the agenda yesterday, so then I noticed it was coming up very quickly next Wednesday, and we have to RSVP by tomorrow. So that is also the same day that I am getting the next Safe Room meeting scheduled as well, but that starts first thing in the morning. So I think this is up in Dual County in Clear Lake, and it starts at noon. So if you want to let me know, I can start getting a head count put together to send to Dual County. Ryan's going to go?
Okay.
Yes. Larry, yes?
I have to do a little rearranging. I'll get back to you.
Okay. Okay. Also on your desk this morning, there were some notes from J.K. Myers that he had taken at a recent meeting that he attended. And the last thing on my report is Laura and I have been looking into scheduling supervisor training. We have a couple of different options. I visited with Greg Vavra with LTAP, and they have a training session, but usually it's about an hour presentation, and they give those at a lot of the conferences that we attend. I'm not sure that's exactly what we're looking for, but he was going to also check with some of his other contacts to see if maybe another group had a different presentation already, if canned, that they could do. I checked with the chamber. They do have some things coming up. I haven't gotten anything as far as cost or time or exactly what they're doing, but they're working on getting something like this put together. And then Laura also looked into doing it's called with Fred Pryor seminars. This is, these would be 3 full-day trainings on like fundamentals of personnel law, dealing with unacceptable employee behavior, and then team building, coaching, mentoring. Those would be the three topics. They're day-long sessions. We would schedule them each like a month apart, so we're not going to ask our department heads to take 3 days in a row out of their of a week. The cost per session is about $3,000, so it's it does cost some money, but as you break it down, and that's up to 20 participants, so if you break it down by cost per person, when you get 3 full days, some of the other trainings that we looked at, like at Southeast, it's very comparable, and Southeast was only at like a few hours of training. Just that, so we're looking at that as well, but I'm still going to wait to hear back from the chamber and LTAP as well. But if there's something, I know that this is something that we think, you know, would be very beneficial, department heads and then others in supervisory positions as well. So if you have any opinions on that, please let me know. And that is all I have for today.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm big into training. I did ask, Stacy did call with that, and I said, just look into a few others. I think providing your employees the tools to be successful as the department heads and management is a crucial part of business. I'm just not sure what the right program, and so if you have some thoughts, please pass them along to Stacy. Okay. All right. Deputy State's Attorney report.
I have nothing to report.
Okay. Somebody else has a meeting to go to. No, just kidding. Commissioner reports. Leanne.
I attended the Safe Room meeting on July 28th, and we are making progress. And one of the rooms in ER is going to be designated for Safe Room. We're looking at the possibility of maybe going up to Watertown, looking at what they're doing at Serenity Hills, seeing if we can incorporate any of that. And I think we're going to reach out and make some contacts with East Central. And we're working on setting up another meeting. I went to the, on July 29th, I went to Million Cups because I wanted to see the Novita presentation by Don Endres. And it was very well received. He talked a lot about what they're doing out there. He had some sample of the product that they're going to be showing, and that was interesting. I have been out to Swiftel several times. I went out for the fashion review contest and the public presentation, and I went out yesterday just to kind of look at what's going on for Achievement Days because I wanted to get a better feel for how we're utilizing our space out there. And from what I could see on the fashion review and the public presentation, actually the space that we're using is too big in that the way we have it set up, and it was nice. I mean, it was really, it's just wonderful to watch these kids doing that. But we had it set up so that if you were in the audience, you couldn't really hear. You know, when the kids came up to do their public presentation to the judges, the acoustics were such, and that those are some things that maybe in the future we can address if we're going to stay out there and look at how we do some of the acoustics. I also went on July 29th. Commissioner Wyseth had talked to Don Dibert, who is a committee from the Lake Campbell Improvement Association looking at doing some sanitary sewer, testing the waters of the lake and what's going on with drainage from sewage systems into the lake. And he had said I would be the person to serve on that.
Well, yeah, place. Well, they were talking ordinance changes and things, and yes, I put them right on to you.
So I did go to that meeting, and it was very interesting. And what we're going to do, they're taking this recommendation back to the Lake Campbell Improvement Association, but the recommendation was to have what's called a caffeine test done on the lake water. I did not know this. So if you have a sewer system, a private sewer system, and you drink coffee or drink soda or whatever, that goes into the sewer system through your waste, and all of the soil filtration, the natural soil filtration stuff does not remove the caffeine. And so you can test the waters to see how much caffeine there is, and you're not getting caffeine from cows or geese or anything like that, and you can get a feel for how much water is coming from those sanitary, everybody's individual sewage systems into the lake. And then if it looks like there's an issue, then the next step will be a different type of test where you're testing each system with some dye. But it was interesting, and we'll be meeting again on that.
That is interesting, and Krogman and I are grinning. I'm thinking of these hyper-northerns that have been caught out there.
So, anyway, that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jensen.
Don't have a lot. Did go up to Honey Days. Also, Gala Days over in Aurora. The parade, Bob Hill was in the color guard for the parade, which was good. Also, Marty's guys, the RSVP guys, were handling traffic control over there and did a good job. The Siren for White was shipped, and it got lost in the shipping. They've located it, and it should be here by the end of the week and installed next week. Don't know what happened there, but it was lost in shipping. So, also plan on going to the 4-H barbecue, be taking tickets, and tomorrow morning I'll be helping with the hog show out there. So,
okay, thank you, Mr. Krogman.
Meetings is when you get the right people in the room, you seem to get things done. And I think in that meeting we had the right people in the room, and after two meetings we're getting some stuff done. So that's a good thing too. Karen from the Brookings Health System there, and Austin Jason and stuff, and they worked on in between of some policies and some paperwork to be able to have better communication with everybody involved and stuff. And it certainly helped having Abby there with her expertise and stuff too. So we're making good headway there, I think. Now it's time to take the next step, and I think we're going to set up a meeting with East Central Behavioral Health, and then also talk about that trip we're taking to Watertown as facilities, what happens after the safe room situation here, because that's not an extended stay place. That's a 24-hour, 48 max type of 48 hours pushing it. So we've got that step. Now it's, okay, where do we go next? And so we had, you know, Sheriff there and Chief Miller there. So I think we had everybody in the room that needed to, and I think we're getting some stuff done. So hopefully we'll be able to continue that. I think we've got a meeting set for the 12th here. That includes Mike Forgy from East Central Behavioral Health, and continue that discussion on this. And so I'm glad to be a part of that one. Also, that afternoon, part of East Central Behavioral Health, I'm on a subcommittee, and we had a meeting there to discuss participation of members and board members. And then was not able to make the hospital board meeting because prior commitments. And then we'll be attending the 4-H barbecue to work on there, my job there to help seat people and carry their stuff when they have four or five kids carrying. I can help carry a little bit of stuff too. So I was surprised. They get a lot of ice cream, milk, and plates, and it's like there is a good amount of food there. So happy I can help out and see everybody there and stop by. So that's about it.
Okay, thank you. Well, last Tuesday I got the call from Bob, and I went over there to Volga, and then I went and checked my farm, make sure I didn't have trees down and cattle running around, and then I went and got my chainsaw because to help one of the citizens there. And I think that needs to be pointed out, the Volga community was out in force. We had one gentleman just had a huge tree just wreck a one-year-old garage with the vehicle still in it, his chainsaw was trapped in there, and that's what I went and got my chainsaw for him. But anyway, I got there. There were bobcats and chainsaws. I mean, they needed me like nothing. They really got after it. And it was good to see that small town spirit going at it. And then Thursday, spent a great deal of time with emails with these two, and over in Novita, and I called you about that, the road out there. And like Commissioner Krogman said, and by the way, I really appreciate the progress you guys have come with the safe room thing. I mean, getting the right people in the room, clears a lot of things. And I think we're set for August 11th. Ryan and I, CDI, Bose Construction, and Novita, we're going to go over that road, and Abby and Dick, we're going to go over that road agreement, make sure everybody's on the same page so we don't have all this communication and sudden decisions. We should have a orderly game plan laid out, and everybody understands what we're working under. So it'll be a chance to clear misunderstandings, misinformation, and all be, maybe, I don't expect any problems. I just think it just needs to all be in the same room.
Yeah, upstairs in the conference room off Michelle's, from next to Michelle up there.
Yes. Larry?
Would it be wise to invite the township people?
Well, it wouldn't.
It just.
Well, if we start, well, I guess it is about 475th. And
the reason I bring that up, some of the roads being used, they didn't even realize that some of the roads are being used in the last couple of weeks. And you can address that in the meeting, too.
Well, Commissioner Krogman, what's your thoughts about the township?
Again, more the merrier, I guess, too. I think the more people that are there that are hearing the discussion, it is not going to hurt anything, and they can put some input in, and then we can make a decision on that too. So I don't think that hurts one bit to find out the issues they're going through and the reasoning behind it. If there's a bigger issue than just the one road, then we maybe have to have that discussion while we're there too. So
okay,
if they're there, doesn't bother me having them there. I think it'd be good communication. I think
is so too. Mark still the chair of the head of the township? Supervisor.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I have a phone call to give Mark anyway on a completely different matter, and I'll mention it to him and then have him get a hold of you, Stacy, and email, and so he's in the loop on that. That's a good point. Yeah, getting all the right. Doesn't do any good to have people outside of issues hanging on the outside, not in the room.
I think it was safe. Yeah. Calls.
Okay. And then I'll be late for the 4-H. You guys are going to have to serve coffee and water or whatever until I have a business meeting until about 6. So but I'll stay for cleanup. So you guys bug out.
Cover cleanup for me, then I'll
like you did last time. And then I stayed. okay. Well, that goes through the meeting. I guess the press is used to coming home around 2 o'clock, so you tell your employers, go have a cup of coffee that the meeting went to 2 and enjoy your lunch. if nothing else, I'll take a motion to adjourn. Second. Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Same sign. Thank you.